Hi guys, I'm Shmi. Hello and welcome back to the channel where, rather confusingly, you are joining me today in Germany. I'm taking a very quick break from my tour in the USA and I've actually left my Ford GT over in Las Vegas, but I've flown over to Stuttgart, Germany, to the home of Mercedes-Benz, where we're outside the Mercedes-Benz Museum. We've got a 6x6 back there and, of course, the rather striking SLS AMG Black Series. Now, many of you will know this is one of my favourite cars in the world. It is absolutely on my dream list, alongside the likes of the Ferrari F50, the Porsche Carrera GT, and if we're going completely to dreamland, the McLaren F1. I've been lucky enough to drive them a few times, and in fact, I drove this very car 2.5 years ago. But one day, one of these is definitely going to find a space in my collection, and today I'd like to talk a bit more about it, tell you why, and take it out for a drive to enjoy the fantastic beast that is the SLS AMG Black Series. Firstly, how stunning is this thing? Without a doubt, one very good looking car, particularly when it's presented in the AMG Solar Beam. This deep pearlescent metallic yellow was the original launch colour for the SLS AMG Black Series, and the same colour that we aimed to replicate just over a year ago when we wrapped my AMG GTR. Now, talking about the GTR, until there is a GTR Black Series, and we can touch more on that later on, I suppose the GTR and the GTR Pro are technically the successors to the SLS Black Series. The SLS Black Series, though, is based on the SLS AMG, the first product that AMG developed entirely themselves, and the Black Series shares the same elongated front end, those gullwing doors that open upwards, and a ferocious 6.2-litre naturally aspirated V8. But there are, however, so many things that changed when they went from the normal SLS to the Black, learnings that came from the SLS GT3 car. So, for example, it is lower, it is stiffer, a new chassis and suspension setup, the bodywork is wider, but also 70 kilos lighter, you have new aero parts, the flicks, the bonnet vent, the side strakes, the fixed rear wing. It also has a titanium exhaust system, and power was raised up to 631 horsepower. But what is it about this car that makes me so much desire to add one to the garage in future? And I think to touch more on that, we should talk about the cars that currently make up my garage. So I'm lucky enough to own 10 in total at the moment, and all but one of them I bought new. And the reason for that is that I so much enjoy the experience of creating the spec of the car, the anticipation of waiting for delivery and then doing the first ever miles in it, that smell of the new car and knowing that it's only had one owner the entirety of its life. Now, when this came out back in 2013, not all that long ago, but before the time that I was in a position to be lucky enough to acquire such cars, of course I didn't have the opportunity to even think about it as much as I loved the SLS. And in fact, I came quite close actually at one point to buying an SLS. I was just a little bit short on the price tag that it required at the time. This, though, could be a reliving of that kind of, I guess, dream back then. It is a car that has always, I think, inspired me. It harks back so much to the history of Mercedes-Benz, those front-engined sporty Grand Tourers, but also the gullwing doors like the 300 SL. They are a thing, well, they're not really going to be seen probably ever again on a car like this, but the looks, the styling, I think it's such a special era almost for Mercedes-Benz, for AMG, the naturally aspirated engines, and this, well, there aren't that many of them. There's been a bit of talk that I've seen online about there only being 150, but that's not actually true. Mercedes USA said there are 150 over there. They announced that as confirmed. That means probably there are about 400, 500 in total in the world. It cost about a 50% markup on the original SLS at the time, on the coupe, so I think about £250,000 for the cars when they launched. Nowadays, well, you don't see right-hand drive ones on the market very often, but the left-hand drive ones, if they're in perfect condition, about 500, maybe 600,000 euros, some used cars for about 450,000 euros. So you can see it is quite different for me to consider such a purchase versus the new cars, because you don't get that new car experience. Yes, you get to own the car and use the car, but you don't go through the whole process. You know that somebody's driven it before you. So that's generally why I don't look into classics, because of the maintenance, because of the difficulties to run them. And even this, at 6 years old, there isn't going to be warranty on the car. You'll still have to look after it and make sure that all is up and running correctly. And that does introduce a bit more cost and time effort as a result. But not having those experiences does detract slightly from me, which is why I tend to go for the brand new cars rather than looking at things that are slightly older. There will become a time, for certain, when I completely change that train of thought and go for all of the cars that I had on posters on my walls when I was a kid, if the opportunity opportunities arise, of course, but this is one I would say from more recent times that always really stood out to me. And in fact, let's come through, just open it up. It's got a little bit windy here, but unlock the car, the door handles pop on out, which look very, very cool, and then they open up like that to reveal this incredibly nice interior. Yes, of course, things like the steering wheel, the infotainment, the small screen are all now ever so slightly outdated. But when you've got what I'm going to show you now in the engine bay, who really cares? Because this is what the car is all about to me. The 631 horsepower, 6.2 litre, naturally aspirated V8 in all its glory, mounted behind the front axle on the suspension setup like the GT3 car, which just gives it such a dynamic driving experience. And yes, the AMG GT and the GTR do an incredibly good job, but this is something else. And you can see here, carbon everywhere, carbon all around the engine bay. You've got the carbon on the underside of the bonnet. I think many parts of the bodywork, not all of it, are made from carbon. You have the exposed parts around the exterior as well. And I always thought this was a really cool design piece. Of course, it has the openings to allow airflow to come through, but visually, the contrast between the exposed carbon and the yellow paintwork is stunning. But I think we should get this fired up, bring it into life a touch. Take a step inside here. Keyless, start stop button. Let's have a little listen then to the startup of the SLS Black. Yes, what a grumble. It's such a cool sound. Let's turn off the radio. So yeah, like I said, these things slightly outdated versus the more modern cars, but who really cares? And this car's done 28,500 kilometers. That's actually really cool. It's had some proper outings, I guess, as the car that they keep on fleet. And like I said, 2.5 years ago, I actually drove this very car during a Mercedes media event at the Nürburgring 24 Hours. That was the first time I drove the SLS Black Series. Since then, I've been lucky enough to drive two more cars, but this is technically my fourth outing now to experience what it's like, and probably the one that is going to cement the need, almost, I could say, that one day one of these is going to have to sit alongside the AMGs that I've been more recently acquiring. Anywho, for the time being, that is ready to be driven and enjoyed. So let's head out on the roads, hopefully without too much traffic, but it is rush hour here in Stuttgart, just to think a little bit more and see if I'm going crazy or how on earth this is going to work. How am I going to make this happen? Let's find out. Small change of plans. As expected, the map is showing disastrous traffic everywhere, so I'm going to fast forward to tomorrow morning, a whole 12 hours or so for me, but for you, just 1 second, and then we'll take it out and hopefully enjoy some roads out in the countryside.
Good morning. Here we go. It is unfortunately rather foggy, but at least it's no longer raining. Getting on the roads, heading over actually towards Forstbach, the home of AMG, where of course the engines and power plants come from and where cars like this are developed. I tell you what though, cruising along, it just feels so unbelievably cool to be in this car. That long, long, long bonnet out in front of you, quite a small cabin because of the way it has this kind of bubble and quite vertical windscreen. And you will notice also I'm following Schmark driving in my Supra, although unfortunately there is now a car right between us. But we're going to head towards some countryside roads just outside of Stuttgart. The traffic, of course, it's early morning, there's been a bit of rush hour traffic, but we will find some countryside where we can have a little bit more fun with this, because if I just turn it right now into manual to start dropping some gears, you've got a 7-speed dual clutch. It sounds so ferocious. That proper naturally aspirated sound. My G63 with the Rentec actually sounds quite similar to this, despite being twin turboed. But this noise, the feel of this car, and obviously this is just sitting on a fairly open road, where it really comes to life is the dynamic capability and the feel of the steering and the handling of it. That's what I like quite so much about the SLS Black, especially even compared to the SLS. They are quite different cars. It's so good. Anyway, let's find some nice roads to enjoy it even more. There's something kind of cool about driving this in the fog today. This car just has so much presence in this color as well. Oh, those sounds. Yeah, just like the previous drives, immediately it is putting this smile on my face. This car is well and truly on my dream list. There's no debate about that. Each and every time, it's just so alive. It's so awake and angry, just ready to be driven. And just these small turns, it feels pinpoint precise. The sun is quickly burning through the fog. We've got the car in manual mode and the twisty roads are beckoning. This is just about perfect. And the thing with this thing is that it really drives like a thoroughbred supercar, despite, of course, the engine being up front. The steering feel is fantastic. Yes, it's very firm, but the downshifts driving in manual now, the feedback it gives you, and I am being aware of slightly damp tarmac on the roads. Those sounds, though, it's so angry and aggressive. And yes, of course, it is very fast as well. But it's the feedback, the rawness of it. I'm a big fan of cars with the engine up front, mid-front mounted engines, where you've got that kind of comfort and Grand Tourer style if you want it. But then you've got the ferocity as well from this, the hardcore nature of it. This car, I'm fascinated by it. Each and every time I drive an S&S Black, I come away feeling the same, which is in a small speed limited section here. The downshifts, they're so quick. The gearbox was sharpened versus the S&S as well. But the Black Series, I mean, they've only made 5 generations of Black Series in total. They started, oh, we've got the traffic information. We don't need that right now. But back out into the open stretches. I love this car. It's one of my favourite cars to drive. And like I say, I'm normally a fan of ordering cars new, brand new, getting to spec them, getting to customise them. But this is one of the few that I would make an exception for. This, the F50 and the Carrera GT. But we should just emphasise right now that a Carrera GT costs almost double this, and an F50 costs about 5 or 6 times this. So very different categories. This is, I guess, in realistic potential territory to add to the garage. Let's pop the gearbox back. You've got a few different gearbox settings, Sport Plus, Sport, and Comfort. You've also got independent adaptive suspension that you can change as well between 2 different modes, but it doesn't really alter with the gearbox. It's not like in the new generation of cars where you have one toggle that will change everything all at the same time. Do you know what? I want to go drive that again. This time around, though, of course, let's go back into manual. Let's press the suspension into the firmer setting to see the differences. Start dropping down some gears. It's so composed, the front end. I mean, it's race car. Like I said, it's developed from the GT3 SLS AMG race car, and you can feel that in the pinpoint precision of the front end. It's so dialed in. Honestly, there aren't many cars like this with this form factor that are so good to drive in terms of steering feel. Yes, it's a massive bonnet. You're sitting way back towards the rear axle. Right, I seem to have a bit of a dilemma. The goalposts have very much moved, and the question is no longer if, but when. I am not going to be able to resist, at some point in time, adding one of these to the garage to enjoy the experience of the car, and just imagine how cool it would be to have this with the GTR Pro, and who knows, maybe a GTR Black Series as well at some point in time too. But this thing, it is just me in a nutshell. It's such an epic, dynamic driving experience. It looks so, so good as well, the aggression of the thing. And then, just to drive it, every time I've driven this car, it has made me smile quite this much. And that says something. That tells you that that's what it's all about. And you know, I've said it many times, these driving experiences won't be around forever. So to enjoy them while we still can, out on the roads like this, at road speeds. What a tremendous, tremendous thing this car really and truly is.
Well, what a drive that has been. in the SLS AMG Black Series. I think you can probably see quite how much I enjoy this car. Now, unfortunately, not quite so much sun on it, but just look at this thing, and particularly around the back and how wide and aggressive it looks. It is so much wider than the standard car, sitting very low, and I just think this is one of the best views. In fact, every view of this car is actually brilliant. The paintwork, when you do get the sun on it, glistens away. One of the best colours, although to be honest, the fact that it was the launch colour for this car means, I think, to me that if I was going for one, I probably wouldn't want it solar beam yellow. I like things to be a little bit different. But in any case, you've got the aggression of all the carbon fibre, the tailpipes, the fixed rear wing actually has a gurney flap just in the back of it, and you can adjust the angle of attack of it as well, so you can pivot it forwards for more downforce or sit it flatter to increase the top speed. But the look of the car, it is so distinct, it is so special, it looks so epic. And in fact, let's just lift open both gullwing doors to see it with the doors up. And although you technically shouldn't, you can drive it very slowly with the doors open, which is just really cool, like the old 300 SL and so many memories that I had of driving that on the Mille Miglia. But this car, I mean, around the front, this is how much wider it is than the standard car. Normally that part of the body would sit outside the headlights, so you can see, get an idea of just how much extra to it there really is. And some very sharp shoulder lines running all the way along and down as well, just enhancing the overall look. I am a big fan of the SLS AMG Black Series, and I think, like I said, this might become a case of when as opposed to if. That's going to be the question. All in due course though, all in due time. For today though, I have had an incredible time driving this car again, a car that, like I said, I last drove about 2.5 years ago. For today though, a big thanks to Mercedes-Benz and to Mercedes-AMG for making it possible to have some fun and enjoy the car. And there will actually be some very exciting things still to come from what I've been up to with Mercedes here in Stuttgart and a Vorderbach. For now though, I need to think long and hard about these things. Let me know in the comments down below what you think. Should there be an SLS Black Series as a future Schmeemobile? That's going to be the question. And what about if it could sit alongside a GTR Black Series? How cool would that be? For now though, I'm looking forward to picking up my AMG GTR Pro in the not too distant future. I need to get myself back over to the USA first, complete my US tour, then get back home, pick up the GTR Pro, and we will go from there. So thank you very much for watching, as always guys. That's it for this time, and I'll see you again very soon. Cheers!